phones, or put a lot of signs. Loads of the usual things. I'm Les Byram, I'm the chair of the meeting, and I declare the meeting open. Recording will now start. Preliminary matters. Apologies received. Councillors Grace and Robbery. Any further apologies to mention? So the next is to ask for any declarations of interest. No? Thank you. There are no matters of urgency, no changes to be made in the running order of the meeting, so we're okay with that. And there are no items of exempt business. Before we start, I just wanted to thank members for, or apologise and say thank you for changing the date of this meeting here today. And also just to mention, as I said just a moment ago, commemorative coins have been made available. After this meeting, Mr. Boyle has pointed out that it is International Call Centre Week, and you know, I think we ought to show solidarity with our great staff who work in control. Sometimes they're not out being seen, but their role, we could not operate as effectively and efficiently as we do without what they do and know. So I thought we'd go down, say hello to them. If you've got the time to be able to do that, just say hello and to record them there. So with that, we've got to the agenda, we've got item 2, minutes of the previous meeting, pages 5 to 14. Can I take that as a correct record, colleagues? So, next, minutes of the previous meeting, of the urgency committee that was held on the 31st of May, pages 15 to 16. Can that be taken as a true record, colleagues? Yes?
Well, yes, Chair, you just referred to them as the minutes of the urgency committee, but the problem is the minutes are the way that now gives the impression it's the full authority. So, perhaps we could have a formal amendment to show that they are the minutes of the agency committee, please.
Okay. Yeah. Would that be agreed? Take it as correct record? Thank you. So we're going to move to the main item on this agenda, which is item 4, the case for adopting the socio-economic duty and proposed next steps, pages 17 to 40.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Look, I'll go through the case report and I intend to take you through a couple of case studies which actually bring to life the adoption of the socio-economic duty. But the case report is to inform members of the proposal presented to the Liverpool City Region Metro Mayor's leaders and Mayor in August 2022, recommending the adoption of the socio-economic duty by the City Region and to capture the proposed next steps and implications for Merseyside by Metro Authority on the adoption of the duty subject to that said approval. And then the recommendations themselves, it's recommended that members note the attached report and the recommendations presented as previously described on the 18th of August 2022, and seek members of their agreement to adopt the socio-economic duty, and as proposed within the report and following the detailed steps that follow. Probably just basically to see members back to both the authority position on recognising the challenges that our communities face every day across Merseyside and probably being more exasperated than we will be in other parts of the country. That resulted in actions taken by the authority to address those inequalities, but equally felt that those inequalities could be addressed more broadly by the City Region, recognising that socio-economic disadvantage affects all aspects of life. What members may not necessarily be aware of, the socio-economic duty was included as part of the Equalities Act back in 2010, but wasn't enacted by the English government at that time, but it was by Scotland and Wales. And I sought to engage with the Equalities Commission on how we could go about seeking and supporting its adoption more broadly. Probably recognising that to overstretch it to get the English government to adopt the socio-economic duty as previously adopted by Scotland, where it might have been a bit of an overreach. But what we sought to do is explore it with the city region and seek an in principle agreement to adopt it more broadly, and hence the reason those conversations took place. And on the 18th of August 2022, a number of recommendations were suggested and adopted, and I'll take you through those in detail. The first one being to endorse in principle the adoption of the socio-economic duty and the request from the Liverpool City Region executives to be upon consultation with their respective leaders to work together in collaboration with Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service and the Chief Officer and all relevant partners to explore arrangements to operationalise and coordinate the adoption of the socio-economic duty, working in the first instance through the city, the Liverpool City Region, local government equalities officers group, with regular updates, progress submitted into the Metro Mayor and the leaders and there. B, to work closely with the Equality and Human Rights Committee, utilising their insights and expertise to allow and support the adoption, to continue to advance and encourage employers across the region to sign and implement the Fair Employment Charter developed by the Liverpool City Region. For the chief executives to be asked to explore the feasibility of adopting the social mobility maturity assessment within their organisations, and need to explore how to influence the Population Health Board and Cheshire Merseyside Health and Care Partnership and use the socio-economic duties to support the way of reducing health inequalities in the region through actions on social determinants of health. And that is broadly the request. And so what is that seeking to do in its most simplistic terms? It's getting the authority and the city region partners to accept, and I know they already do, the socio-economic disadvantages that are affecting our communities, and to have that as one of their key factors, much akin to the way you would look at equalities impact. We look at equalities impact against the 9% characteristics, but we would include socio-economic disadvantage in those considerations. Why is that important? I think it's probably self-evident for everyone in this room. But by way of bringing that into the spotlight and showing and demonstrating what it means from an authority point of view, on the basis of us adopting the socio-economic duty, there's two approaches which I would draw your attention to. The authority previously had chosen to extend the home fire safety checks to the most deprived communities in Merseyside. Previously were targeted individuals based on their vulnerabilities around age, mobility, etc. But really we started to recognise that some of our communities were facing really financial challenges and were choosing to put food on the table rather than put smoke alarms up on the ceiling. As a result of that, we chose to go back into those communities to provide smoke alarms and home fire safety check free of charge to ensure that their safety was protected throughout. That innovation, let's say, is an application of the adoption of the socio-economic duty, factored in gain deprivation of one of the key causal factors of fire and fire death. And you can do that as part and parcel of that outward service delivery, but there's also a reflection in regards to our recruitment and how we recruit people into the organisation to reflect the communities that we serve. And one of the key factors in that was we knew as part and parcel of our requirements that someone would be able to drive, that there was individuals who were disproportionately affected by that. So if you were living in the more poor areas of Merseyside, those most socially deprived, in the nicest possible way, people who live in those communities could hardly put themselves through driving lessons given the financial challenges that they and their families were suffering, and they could be absolutely perfect individuals to work for this authority, as firefighters or any other role for that matter. So we sought to remove one of those barriers. So the first thing we done in regards to that was remove the necessity to have a driving licence at the point of application. Members will see page 28 of the pack. You will see the figures. We attracted 195 applicants who did not hold a driving licence into the role of firefighter. And using the national levels of deprivation, 84% of those applications without a driving licence resided in the 50 most deprived areas of Merseyside. And focusing on 10% most deprived decile of Merseyside, 48% of the applicants without a driving licence lived in these areas. So self-evidently, there were people being held back from applying to Merseyside Fire Rescue Service because of the high levels of deprivation that they were residing in. Notwithstanding that, the fact is that you probably can't necessarily see within this report, what you'll also see is that the diversity of the recruitment has improved significantly on the basis of that too. Because not only are some of our communities more deprived and the individuals affected by that levels of deprivation,
intention
to do in the longer term to create the bursary. So when I say at point of application, you know, we know based on our recruitment scheduling that we're able then to give someone a conditional offer based on the fact that they can drive at the point of entry into the service, which means they've got a reassurance that they have a job, and then they can invest in and secure the driver license requirements. That said, we are proposing to introduce a bursary scheme. So not only that, if they are really challenged in regards to their financial ability to put themselves through driving lessons prior to entering into their finances, we'll provide a bursary scheme on that in principle agreement that they would become an employee of the service, and that will remove that barrier into employment for those said individuals. And that has not only been recognised as case studies within the city in own rules, that actual case study has now made its way into documentation nationally around apprentices and apprenticeships in regards to how you are the challenges that face our communities in the moving into an apprenticeship. So it should be very important, but the actual purpose of the report is to have the authority approve and adopt socio-economic duty in partnership with the Liverpool City Region, which what is being proposed as part of those recommendations. Pause and take any questions.
Thank you. Again, part of the innovation that there won't be any other authorities in the country doing this. Part of the innovation, particularly we know our community. Our community needs this sort of action. Questions?
Thanks, Chair. Just to say that back in 2008, Richard Wilkinson and Kate Pickett released a book called The Spirit Level. And in it, they set out how societies which are more equal perform better economically and also have fewer social problems. And that evidence has been corroborated time and time again in further academic studies. I agree with the Chief about the Equality Act. We know that the socio-economic deprivation duty was included in the Act, but it required a statutory instrument in order to be implemented in England, which hasn't happened yet, but I cross my fingers. I'm glad to see public bodies taking that into their own hands and just deciding to do it themselves. And I'm glad to see the Merseyside Fire and Rescuers as well. What I would say though is that I believe that Merseyside Fire and Rescue has already been taking this into account for a long time. We've already been targeting the most deprived parts of Merseyside because we know that's how we keep people safest. We know that that's often where the most support is needed anyway. But it's still good to see this formalised and written up into the actual papers of what we do and what we stand for. Thank you.
We've also done some work. Professor
Michael Mond.
Professor Mond, who's one of the most respected advocates and practitioners in the effects of deprivation on people's lives. And he has used Merseyside as a case study on a number of occasions. And he came here and spoke to a meeting of officers some years ago. And I've been to things that Marlis has spoken to as well. And he has a lot of time for Merseyside.
consent, you know, like everything else, we're consenting on some of the sensitivities that we will discuss and share that our matrices would always be on an individual basis if people wanted to provide consent or not provide consent. But if you get the pitch right and you understand what the purpose of it is, and that bill can focus in on tackling inequality, then you hope that the consent would be given. But, you know, then everything that follows with the protection, you know, GDPR and so on and so forth will be managed accordingly. But being able to demonstrate for the city region, 5 years henceforth, about what the impact has been of the adoption of the socio-economic duty, you know, that's why we are including kind of conversations with the Equalities Commission, because they're already evidence and some of those things. They will already be looking for some of that evidence to support it and be able to demonstrate, you know, that Merseyside is different. You know, things have been levelled more on the basis of the adoption of the duty, so they will be very keen to support not only the universities but the academic rigour that they can provide as the Equalities Commission too. So, you know, around organisational capacity in the next possible way, I don't intend to do all of the work. I just intend to lead a kind of a movement, if that makes sense, around the adoption of the duty in the first instance, and then we will see what flows from there. So be assured that I know my limitations, and my limitations are to lead Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, but to influence more broadly around the city region.
Thank you. I mean,
I've spoken directly about it. I think we've introduced the kind of conversation principle. That's a perfect opportunity. I thought I've gone into it in the depth with the representative body, because like anything else, when you share that with the city region leaders, the groundswell of absolutely this is the right thing to do for Merseyside, where the inequalities are so prevalent and the high deprivation levels that we are facing every day, it becomes in the nicest possible way an easy pitch. It doesn't have, I don't consider to be any opposition, certainly it was fully supported by the city region, because we all recognise that actually James's point, we are doing these things every day anyway. It's just trying to put a little bit of process in, so we think about it a little bit more than just a passive learning. So it's not something that necessarily I've engaged more broadly on. What we have started to communicate through some of the communications internally around this is what we're doing, this is why we're doing it, this is why we target deprivation, home safety, this is why the networks are focused in on recruitment and how we can take away some of the barriers from employment. So it's out there, it's understood, and got to mess it rather than necessarily being directly, we're going to do this, what do you think?
Thank you.
It's truly innovative and it's good to see that this is happening. I just wanted to just, on page 37, where it's got a set of questions, and I'm just wondering about asking about this when you're age 14. Interesting, as time goes on, this is kind of embedded, is that one of the things around there saying about preschool meal eligibility, we know at this stage we've got an awful lot of people who, or young people who are not able to access preschool meals, but we're in financial circumstances relating on their family that they actually fall into that bucket. It's just in a tick box exercise with regard to what they actually get, they just don't get it. So I'm just wondering, what are the flexibilities going forward to think about how you capture more people who might be falling through a net effectively?
Yeah, okay. I think this is probably not the direct answer to your question, but hopefully you understand the kind of response. I think you started some of this stuff right. Start to think about inequality, then the people who are arguably on the cusp or fall through the net or don't get picked up naturally, because we are doing things differently, because we're trying to capture or address the inequalities that exist for a smaller group of individuals, but it spreads more widely than that. And the reason why the questions are the questions, not Merseyside Fire Rescue, it's not
talk about a golden thread. And if a golden thread, we said, you know, our corporate aim was to be the best fire service in the world, the people of Merseyside deserve that. There's nothing wrong with that at all. That's a great aspiration. We would say we're there already. But, you know, that's a great aspiration. That doesn't necessarily mean 5.5 minutes attendance time, very, very shiny fire engines and a lovely uniform. It actually means helping your community, putting in place checks and balances that will help the community in what's more. We are not a social services body. We are a fire and rescue service, but we've also become very inspirational and very supportive of the work that has been done by many, many other agencies, and that's our role. Not to directly in see where we can, but influence and guide and help where we can as well. So in that respect, this policy can be the golden thread through what we do. And so when we come to an agenda, you know, at the end of the agenda, there's a financial implications, economic environmental implications, equality and diversity implications, we can have a section that says, social inclusion. Does this report, these decisions that you're proposing to take, do they improve the social inclusion of the people of Merseyside and the wider area? And that we can test ourselves on. And we can, over a period of time, we can say, well, look, we did this, we did this, we did this, we did this. Because we want Merseyside, yes, to be the best, but also to reflect the makeup of the community that we represent. In terms of quality and diversity, but also we know we come from a challenged, an economically challenged, urban area, 260 miles away from London. Maybe that's a good thing now, the madness going on down there, maybe doesn't contaminate us up here. But we're a long way from the centre of power, but we can have influence. This is what Steve's trying to do with devolution in this region, in the city region, and to say, well look, there's the extra, we're throwing it on the table, there's the extra that we're doing. And great ideas, you know, articulated in a report like this. This is the start of it, and it's where we take it on from here. So, colleagues, the recommendation is there on page 17 and 3. Is that agreed? So I'd ask that if an infographic or something that would just say in simple terms what it is we're proposing to do here to be sent out to every member with a request that you then cascade that down to your colleagues on your council and your own networks and just to say this is what Merseyside is trying to do in our community. So hopefully, it may take a little while, but that will come out. Right, thank you. So next item is 5, the award of the contract for the design and supply of ELS vehicles, pages 41 to 46. But note that this is a decision that already, because of the time constraints, and this meeting having been moved, a decision that was made on chief officer action, which needs to be ratified. Leah, do you want to add anything
to that? It was just to say that obviously we did that under delegated. It was mainly due to the moving of the authority meeting and that the time critical and time zone for the parts now is obviously extending the time period for the infrastructure upgrading these vehicles. It's getting out through national resilience, it's obviously funded already through the national resilience budget and it's just over that fact.
We manage a lot of money on the national stage and we're just buying these on behalf of other. Okay, so a couple of, if that's the last item on the agenda, unless there's anything else there.
Just ask members to note that decision.
Is that decision being noted or ratified, effectively?
Yes. Great,
thank you. So a couple of sort of parish notices. The county fantastically has been awarded the Eurovision final. So I think it would be very useful for us as a fire service, you know, in terms of all the things we do, to very active participant, what would I say? Well, yes, well, let you grow up, yes, I'm rather tired of my pretty monk here, or whatever, you know. But, you know, I think we should get in with this wholeheartedly, give all support that we possibly can to that, and, you know, we'll have more information coming on this. There's obviously safety issues of the event itself, but there's all sorts of stuff. We can get our message out about fuel poverty and fire safety issues through that medium as well. Also, Knowsley is the Borough of Culture, and we'll be opening the Shakespeare of the North End, but I think open now. But, you know, there's all sorts of stuff around that marvellous facility there that we need to do some stuff on. It's the Halloween bonfire period coming up. If anybody has any issues in their own authorities relating to public events, distraction events, the removal of bonfire materials, you know where to come. And we're going to get maximum support, as usual, for this whole period in time. And then to say that there's a policy and resources meeting in December. This is the last meeting of the authority of the year. So a happy Christmas and a very safe and prosperous 2023. I'll close the meeting. Oh, would the members just hold back and close the meeting now, and we just hold back to just finish quickly some of the comments that we made, some of the things we're just discussing before the meeting starts.